room in right center field if MJ pulls the ball. And he does, and gets into it well. Deep to right. That's a way back, and it is gone. Home run, MJ Melendez. He has the Royals back in front at 4-3.
The kids win again.
They get it, man.
B-Dub. You sweating a little bit?
Man, look. dinner was a struggle last night,
mean,
right?
They're on
the
your heels
pressure
now.
Is on.
46th win last night. The last I checked, the last weigh-in, you were at 47 pounds lost.
Yeah.
So they're coming for you.
You better kick
they
it into
hot.
Second gear, my friend. You better get moving.
Man,
you didn't
this
expect
is third
this
gear.
right now from the Royals, huh?
I did not expect this, but this is a pleasant surprise, and I'm here for it. You know, the kids look great last night, didn't they?
You got out to April and May like they should have.
Exactly.
And then now
I've hit that plateau.
You've hit the swoon of, you know, July and August here.
Well,
while
I took
starting
off
to play
so much already. Yeah. Now it's hard, even though with the body composition changing. Still, it's only 1 pound a week, and I'm like, and these guys, they're rolling off 3 or 4.
That's the healthy way to do it.
I mean,
you got to do it like 1 pound per week. They say that's the best way to do it. You don't want to go out there and lose 10 pounds in 1 week because that's just not healthy. But when you're going against a hot baseball team like they are right now, brother, you got to step it up.
Last night, what was it, the bottom of the sixth or bottom of the seventh after the White Sox took the lead and Melendez comes up, and, I mean, he crushed it.
Right.
I was like, here we go.
yeah.
I got to run back downstairs real quick.
Get back down to the treadmill and get a couple of more miles in today.
I'll have tuna and crackers tonight,
right? Well, you've got an intern in here for the next 2 days who can make sure that you get all the nutrients that you need this morning when it comes to the fruit platters and things like that. So that will be a lot of fun to watch because at 20-41, I'm sure you were like, yeah, I got this in the bag. There's no question.
We were talking about doubling it up, remember?
Yeah, right.
There was a point in time where we were doing that. For those that don't know, B-Dub has tried to lose more weight than Royals wins this year, and he's got 47 pounds down.
47,
is what we said.
Yeah.
And the Royals now have 46 wins, and at 20-41, B-Dub is like, I'm down 40 already. Like, you were doubling them up. And now all of a sudden they've hit a stride. They've hit fire. They're fun to watch again. I thought the best part about that Melendez home run, guys.
Day game after night game, you better hit the gym early as soon as work's over.
Day game after night game, you get your tail down to the gym and work things out today. But I think what the best part about the Melendez blast last night was the way he celebrated and pointed to the ground as he was rounding first base and showed some enthusiasm. I mean, I hate to say, I don't want to be one of these I told you so. But when we had that conversation about a month ago, but I didn't think it was going to be like this. I just had one of those, like, you know, just got back from watching the Orioles in Baltimore. We've been watching a lot of Orioles. I'm like, these guys are just having fun. The Royals weren't having fun, and now they're having fun, and it's all about that. And I was in the clubhouse yesterday talking to some folks about it, and I'm not going to sit here and lie, and I don't really care what anybody thinks about this comment that I'm about to make. It is night and day different right now from when Whit Merrifield and Andrew Benintendi were in the clubhouse, and somebody tried to tell me, you can't say it's better because they're gone. We're winning some games now. I'm like, no, I'm going to say it's better because they're gone, because as one person told me yesterday, remember that, I think it's Andy Reid who had the saying, or maybe it's Vermeil, I don't remember anymore. There's energy givers and there's energy suckers. Whit Merrifield and Andrew Benintendi were kind of energy suckers inside that clubhouse. I walked in there yesterday and it was as lively, Josh, as it was in 14 and 15. And we remember those days very vividly. You'd walk in, it was lively. Guys were out there having a good time, playing cards, hanging out. The music was blaring. They were playing a lot of this country and Western music, though, yesterday.
Both kinds, yeah.
Both?
Like Nicky has taken over the leadership of that clubhouse. He's got a huge-ass boombox sitting in the corner. Like, there is no sign that Whit Merrifield even existed. I mean, like, even his bottled water is no longer inside the clubhouse, right? And they're bumping tunes yesterday, and it was like, my dad died, my mom died, I'm 6 feet apart from you. Like really morbid, like, country. Country and Western songs, and I'm like, it doesn't matter though. Whatever music they like, they're playing, they're having a good time, and it was a loose atmosphere. It was a fun atmosphere, and I keep telling people this Vinny Pasquantino cat, you like him on the field, you're gonna love him even more off the field. The man bought a Sauce Gardner jersey who buys a Sauce Gardner jersey, right? I'm like, my God, why do you have that? He goes, I like the Jets. I'm like, why? You know, nobody likes the Jets. You don't get people to readily admit that. But it is a loose clubhouse right now, and it's making all the difference. And somebody goes, well, we're winning. That's why it's like that. I go, no, you got to be loose. You got to have fun. You got to enjoy going to work every single day. And if you don't, your work isn't going to be any good. These guys now have that freedom. And I think one of the analogies that was used about this team is like when Bobby first came up, Bobby Wood Jr., that is, he came up by himself and he was put into a clubhouse that was already kind of established. And he was like the new kid at school, just trying to find a way to fit in. And you know how that goes. You start to conform to maybe some of the other people in the school, and maybe you get in with the wrong crowd or you're not being yourself because you're just trying to fit in. Now it's like Bobby Witt Jr.'s got all his buddies from elementary school, and they all went to the new school together, and they've all had this bond, and they're all having a good time, and they're all loving it, and they're winning games. And that's the important thing right now. Go out there and have fun, and have fun playing Major League Baseball. They were not having fun playing Major League Baseball before the trade deadline, and now they are, and look what they're doing. They're winning games, they're having fun, and they're getting people excited for Royals baseball moving forward again. Josh, I think it's great right now. Do it in April, too.
And they're keeping Tony La Russa up at night.
And they are so keeping Tony La Russa up at
like
night.
Way up at night.
Yeah.
They sent him coffee last night.
How is La Russa seriously getting through this series? When you think about it, right? They had a doubleheader, and he was sleeping until like the eighth inning, and they flipped the lights on the other day. Baseball? Hall of Fame manager. Who are you? Shine a light in my face. So he had a doubleheader. And then came back for a night game yesterday. The Royals forbid anybody to show up before 4 o'clock yesterday, which was a good move on their part. 4 o'clock for La Russa's dinner time. He's in there eating mush and trying to figure out carrot and raisin
and
salad.
And there ain't nothing wrong with that.
No, there's not. No. I try to eat dinner around 4 o'clock every day, too, if I could, right? And so you got the day game today after the night. Like, this week for La Russa it's got to be a tough week for him.
Where you're looking at yourself and you're like, why am I doing this to myself?
Right. Yeah, right, yeah. So, I mean.
Came back for this?
If you're Tony La Russa, man, it is a tough, tough, tough stretch of games here in Kansas City. And so now they got that day game today. I don't know if La Russa's up for that one. I don't know if he's going to make it to the dugout.
Baseball. Going back to the fun.
Got to watch the stories.
The end of the game, Massey was the guest on the field with Joel Goldberg, and Melendez and Bobby Witt have taken over, you know, the Salvi splash.
The Salvi's getting old. It's
right. But last night they did kind of like a little fake out. Melendez was coming straight at Massey. Massey went for the dunk, but Bobby Witt Jr. was behind both Goldberg and Massey, hit him, and they're having fun. You know, they're having high five and blah, blah, blah. It's all great. So you can see that infectious energy is starting to translate throughout, just not on the field, but off the field and in the locker room, like you said, and just having fun again. We need that. You know, you want to see that. You want to see that energy take over, because then it translates to the crowd, because the crowd was great last night, too.
Yeah. I mean, isn't it more fun as a fan to watch this stuff, too? Like, aren't you enjoying it a lot more than what we were watching? Like, I even said to you guys the other day, I said, I don't watch these games with anxiety and hate anymore. You know, I'm enjoying watching these young kids play, because I think for a while there we were hate watching. I mean, you're 20 and 41. You're like, oh, my God, what are we doing?
I'm not drifting ahead. I don't know. I wouldn't know what the record was, except for I'm B-Dub's weight.
Right.
Right.
That's it.
Yeah.
So I don't know I don't even know what the loss total is. I just know what the win total is at this point. So other than that, I'm not looking at the standings.
I think they're exactly 20 games under. Right
and
now,
I'm not.
Or maybe 19.
And I'm not projecting what this, like, there's a lot of people who want to project, well, what does this mean? I'm not doing any of that.
No, you can't do any of that, because none of it means anything.
I'm just enjoying what's happening right now.
Right.
And it's a lot more fun to watch right now.
Yeah.
That's it.
It's enjoyable. That's like it's relaxing
now. Looks like there's some good talent. Looks like they're having a lot of fun. I don't know what it means for next. I'm not there.
Right.
I'm not letting myself go there. Mm-hmm. That's really what it is, because I don't want to fall into that trap, because they still have to prove it in April and May. Still have to get to a fast start. This stuff is infuriating if you let it be infuriating, right?
Right, yeah.
That if you say, why wasn't this going the direction it was going then? But also now does not equate to anything in the future.
No.
Other than it's kind of fun right now. And okay, next... I'll give you some attaboys, and next April, let's go win games then.
And that's the big thing. And if they don't get off to a hot start in April, then they're going to have to make some changes, and things will get ugly. But I think right now, with the way that things are going right now, with these kids getting kind of that taste of winning, I think they kind of like it. I think they like the fun that they're having down there in the locker room.
I just like to see
they're hanging out with each other.
Teams, if you said they were going to play this many rookies, are usually terrible.
Mm-hmm.
And no one wants to go, and they're not spending money. It's a team accused of not spending money,
yeah,
and being cheap, and they're just playing a bunch of nobodies. Well, these aren't nobodies.
This is the entire farm system.
This is what you want to see if you're going to go young.
Yeah.
Like, this is all your talent right here. Some move probably early.
Mm-hmm.
And let's see where it goes. I'm excited about that portion of
yeah,
it for sure.
I am too. I'm excited to see these young guys, but also, you know, you mentioned how it equates to next season, and I'll continue to say this. We've got a good young core now that we're watching. It is up to ownership to supplement now going forward and making and allowing the front office to either A, make a big trade with somebody that we may like on the roster right now. I saw some people on the text line yesterday during Vern's show were talking about could Melendez be that piece that gets us the James Shields trade back in return. I think if you want to take that next step, there's going to be a hard trade that probably has to be made, but that's okay. You need to make those trades. You need to move forward. I mean, I think the Will Myers trade worked out very well for everybody involved, and he's been a very solid Major League Baseball player, but he's never won a championship anywhere or really put up numbers that say MVP every year like people thought when he was here in the Royal system. So it's okay to trade some of those prospects. There may be a guy that you love right now that's on the team that may have to be traded for this team to take the step forward.
Much easier. I mean, look at the outrage that happened when that one happened, but much easier to do if you haven't seen them.
Yeah,
that's a little bit of the problem.
It is. Sure it is.
Like, because if you move somebody, you probably seen them play at this point.
Yeah.
Maybe a little more difficult to do.
It may be somebody that's up here right now, right? It may be MJ Melendez. He may be the guy that you're able to get the most back for in return. It may be Nick Prado. It may be Vinny Pasquantino. I don't think it's going to be Vinny. He's beloved inside that organization right now, so I don't think it would be him, but it could be somebody that you're seeing on the field every single day that the organization says this is our best chance to take that next step forward, but it's going to be ultimately it's up to ownership to allow them to go out there and do that, to allow them to have a payroll that's bigger than where it is right now, to allow them to go out there and spend the extra cash. And I think right now, if you look at where this team is and you believe in Dayton and you believe in JJ and you believe in Mike Matheny, then you have no choice as ownership than to open the purse strings up a little bit and let them go make those final two moves that I believe, outfield and starting pitching, one starting pitcher, one outfielder that can rake, you allow them to go out there and make those moves. If they aren't able to make those moves and you don't allow them as ownership to make those moves, then maybe you're not believing in what you're seeing right now. And that therein lies another problem that I don't think we have, but we're just pulling back all the peels. But I think right now the front office can sit back and go, we've done a really nice job of bringing up these young kids. We need a little bit of supplemental talent. We got to go out and make a couple of big moves this offseason. Ownership, will you allow us to do that?
Back at it this afternoon, 1:10, first pitch here on 610 Sports Radio, and Vern's got your on-deck show today at noon. Amazon is trying to make your sports holiday come true. Tell you what, next.
This is Fesco in the Morning, brought to you by Santa Fe Auto Sound, your home for car audio since 1967, on your official broadcast partner of the Kansas City Chiefs, 610 Sports.
Back in on a Thursday, along with Bob Fesco, I'm Josh Klingler, Brian Williams, B-Dub, our producer slash musical director. I'm not a big day after Thanksgiving shopper. Never have been. Never had the need to go and stand in line to get a television or a Cabbage Patch Kid the day after the day after Thanksgiving.
Your stores are open other days,
Elmo.
Right? Yeah, the Tickle Me Elmo is a big one, too. I forgot
now
about
I have,
that.
Now, thing. I have online purchased
right.
that day, right, when everything's on sale or whatever. But it's kind of a holiday.
Mm-hmm.
We don't work that day.
No, it's kind of a national holiday,
yeah.
too. Yeah.
Hopefully we continue to not work that day. This right? may spoil it. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
No. Well, it depends on who it is. Eh. Yeah.
Depends on what happens.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
So next season, they believe it's happening, a Black Friday game in the NFL. Mm-hmm.
Is that a popular game? Would that be a game that you want to play in? Because I feel like that's going to be like a 3 o'clock Friday afternoon game. Now, from a fan standpoint, that is a drunk fest. I'll tell you what.
So Amazon,
if you could still drink after eating on Thursday,
has reportedly put in a bid between $70 and $100 million for the rights to broadcast the game.
For one game?
Correct. Isn't that insane?
Say the number
one
again.
One game.
$70 to $100 million.
And I'll refresh your memory, and I'll say this as many times as I can. The Royals get $50 million for 162.
For a whole season, yes. That's correct.
That's $70 million for one game or for a series
it
of games?
I'm guessing it'd probably be for X amount of years or whatever.
Well,
you get,
per
you
year, get though, right? I would imagine that's got to be per game, John. Really do.
I know.
I'm guessing that's probably per game. Yeah.
Like the wasn't it like a billion for Monday nights or something? I mean, it was like some stupid number.
Some stupid number for Monday night football. Yeah.
So, triple header on Thursday.
Right.
Still playing Sunday and Monday, and then adding Friday.
Yeah. Yeah. I like it. I used to be like resistant to this kind of stuff, and I'm like, no. But now the more I think about it, the more I'm like, the more football for everybody, the better. Now it is, you know, ruining the Sunday ticket type of thing because you pay extra, obviously, for that, which I've done for, you know, 30 years now, or however long it's been for Sunday ticket. You start to peel games away from that. Doesn't make that as valuable. But if you're getting $70 to $100 million for one game every year, who the hell cares what you're doing the NFL Sunday ticket, right? And you get the opportunity for everybody to watch more primetime games. And again, it's why the National Football League continues to maintain its place on top, is that they give people the opportunity to have more. And we want that right now. I mean, we've got preseason football starting tonight, technically. And, you know, how much preseason football do you watch if it's not your team? Probably not a whole heck of a lot. But the Baltimore Ravens are going for their 21st preseason win tonight. I'm like, I'm actually kind of intrigued by that. They haven't lost a preseason game since 2015. I'm like, that kind of intrigues me. If that game's on, I may sit there and see what happens in that football game. But we love the NFL, and I just think more NFL for everybody, the better right now. And if you're able to get that kind of money and you know, kind of line your coffers with $70 to $100 million divided by 32, that's a good chunk of change for every team in the league.
Yeah.
You're going to take that. I'm not going to get upset anymore. We're like, you can't have a game that day. We got Texas playing Texas A&M or whatever. Nobody cares.
Iowa, Nebraska, come on.
Yeah, we don't care about that anymore. That's all off the radar. I'm just wondering what time it's going to be.
I don't want to schedule anything against Iowa, Nebraska. I feel like I have a free day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
You've like, got an obligation to protect that game.
That's my free, you know, can't always catch a Saturday to travel and whatever.
Sure.
So leave that one alone.
That's the one we could do. Yeah.
For selfish Josh. Oh,
yeah.
You want to go to that game? Yeah. I see what you're saying.
Been in that game a couple times. Now.
Well, I see. I don't know if the Friday
good,
after Thanksgiving game is a popular game. Like, if you're the Chiefs, do you want to be on that game? You know.
I would think.
I'd rather play Thursday. I'd rather play Thanksgiving from that standpoint.
It's a good kind of football day, though.
It is a good football day. I mean,
there's always good games on that game. They're kind of standalone.
Yep.
So you are crowding into that. So I think it would probably work for the NFL too, just fine.
And maybe they play the night game, a Friday night game or something,
they
and
could.
Do something different. And I know like the NFL has got some rules in place where they can't do Friday and Saturday games before a certain day because it infringes on the high school and college. Like they've had some kind of handshake agreement or whatever with everybody for all these years. And I actually think it may be a legally binding agreement. Like there's something that says they can't play those Saturday games until mid-December. That's why we don't see November Saturday games or anything like that. But to try this experiment and see what a Friday night game looks like, I think it'd be a lot of fun. My dad always used to tell me, he goes, man, I wish the NFL played on Friday night. He goes, but then that gets in the way of high school football, which it does. And you don't want to get in the way of high school football. That's your grassroots. That's growing the next generation of players, right? You want to be able to still have high school football be an important thing. And quite honestly, Josh, high school football has become more and more important in communities than it really has ever been. I mean, everybody supports the high school football.
Well, your dream
now.
To go to the NFL. How are you going to have that dream if you're playing opposite?
It's never
quite made sense.
No.
So I wouldn't.
You don't want to take eyeballs away from high school football either, where people are staying home and not supporting their local high school or whatever going on. So I don't have a problem with doing it on Black Friday because it is a day where basically everybody's off and there is no more high school football usually at that point of the year. And so you get the opportunity to do that. If you were putting a Friday night game in September and October, I'd be like, all right, now you're infringing on the high school stuff. But this time, this holiday standalone game, I'm all for it. I think it'd be a lot of fun.
Speaking of placement of games, there are two NFL preseason games tonight opposite the Field of Dreams game.
That's right. Yes.
Like, should they? I mean, I know they're exhibition football, but I'm like, shouldn't you play this game last night?
Yeah, you should have played it last night.
Shouldn't you play this baseball game last night?
Yeah. I know.
And not go up against even preseason NFL football.
Right. Absolutely.
Feels like you should have your baseball.
I think you're absolutely right about that. If you're baseball, you've got to do a better job of jockeying the schedule and figuring out where there are kind of like holes in that schedule. Because as we know, it doesn't matter. The NFL preseason game the other night at the Hall of Fame put up better numbers than the NHL Stanley Cup Finals and the NBA Finals.
Yeah. I don't think there's a network game, though, tonight. I think it's NFL Network only tonight. But still. I feel like you want this baseball game to be another marquee tune-in event, and you're playing again against football and just even practice football.
Yeah. Is it a marquee event, though? Like, I felt last year was. Clearly last year was that first marquee event. This year, I don't see as much buzz and hype as we did for a season ago, because I don't think you can make it completely unique and different. You can't roll Kevin Costner back out there and have him do his thing again, right? We've already done that.
I wouldn't
think
so, no.
You can't do that again because everybody saw that. Everybody loved that when it happened last year. You can't continue to go back to the well. I think for baseball's standpoint, this should be the last Field of Dreams game. If they want to use the field like the other night, they played some minor league games
up
there. That's really cool.
I actually tuned in. MLB Network did it.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, a couple of Midwest League teams that were playing.
Yeah.
And they moved the game and they dressed them in, you know, old uniforms and use some of their old time names.
Sure.
And made an event. I'm like, wow, they should have been doing this for decades in Iowa. I don't understand why this is taking so long.
Yeah.
But then it led you, oh yeah, when's the major league game? Oh, it's on Thursday night. I'm like, okay. I'm like, I'm pretty sure there's football.
Yeah. But it was Thursday night last year. It was the Yankees and it was the White Sox last year, but it was a unique experience. Everybody was excited for it. There was a lot of hype leading up to that.
I mean, the
game
tickets are still good. I mean, you got to pay 500 some bucks to get in tonight. So
it's a lot of money.
It's going to be full. It's going to be popular.
Right.
But is it going to be baseball popular, which is regional, whatever?
Right.
Like Cubs and Reds has a draw in Chicago and Cincinnati. Is it going to have the full scale draw? It's going to be on Fox, so maybe.
It may be. Yeah.
There's no football on Fox, right? They're doing baseball tonight, so it's got a chance. But yeah, you're right. There hasn't been the buzz like there was before.
Yeah, is there an opportunity for you to know a Red going into this game?
Tickets as low as $518.
That's good. I'm glad the prices are up there though. It shows that there's a demand and people want to go.
Pirates, right? Diamondbacks this afternoon for $11.
Yeah, but that's not playing in a cornfield, right?
It says Royals White Sox, you go for $6.
Yeah, wow. So. Just tell them you just tell them when you walk up to the gate, you know, one of the players, they may let you in.
So it's a little bit different zone, but you're right. You have two non-winning teams too playing in this one.
Yep.
So yeah, there's less buzz for it. I just don't like the head-to-head with the NFL.
Let me ask you this though. I mean, the price tag, right? $518 to get in, right? Which I think is obviously high. I'm not paying that, but it goes to show you what people truly want though, Josh. They want unique experiences that don't happen a lot. And that's what baseball needs to do more of. And I don't know if you could play on the Bull Durham set, or obviously you can't play on the major league set because the county stadium in Milwaukee has been torn down. So you can't play there, but there's gotta be ways to continue to create these unique experiences where you don't overdo it. And that's what kind of scares me with, like, we saw the stadium game get overdone in hockey, right? And I still think people go in those cities, but it's not like it was that first game that we all watched in the snow on New Year's Day. We're like, oh my God, this is the greatest thing ever, right? People, like, I think at this point in our lives, we like these unique experiences. And at $518 to get in, clearly people are willing to pay for those unique experiences. So I wish baseball could find a way to really create those unique experiences, whether it's going back to London like they're doing next year with the Cardinals and Cubs, the Mexico City games that they're going to have. They're starting to do a lot of international games as well in Major League Baseball. I just don't know what the answer is here in the United States when you try to do these unique experiences like we're going to see tonight up in Iowa, and we saw a year ago up in Iowa with that unique experience. But that's what people like right now. And I think if you give people more of these unique experiences, well, I hate to say it, they will come. And we saw the Royals play in Omaha a couple of years ago. That was a pretty cool, unique experience. Maybe you start doing things like that where you peel off a home game and you play at a stadium that's regionally close to you to give fans something different to latch onto, because 81 of the same thing are boring.
Deck of an aircraft carrier. Let's go.
Let's go. Deck of an aircraft carrier. Yes, absolutely.
Back to school is upon us, along with one of our biggest nightmares. Next.
You're listening to Fesco in the Morning, brought to you by Santa Fe Auto Sound, your home for car audio since 1967. The show first to breaking news in Kansas City.
So apparently, if you've pooped yourself on Lucky Charms, go to iowaspoison.com.
610 Sports Radio.
Gotta love Tom Petty on a Thursday.
A thirsty Thursday.
On Thursdays, we should play all music artists that start with T. Because T for Thursday.
A little alliteration action?
Yeah, people like alliteration, okay. Don't they?
Yeah, they do.
Yeah,
they do. It's here. Like it or not.
Oh, I love it. I'm not
No, I get sad this time of year. I don't like this.
You don't like this time of year?
No,
I get you.
It went fast.
It did.
You said that every year. It did.
Yeah, this year it did.
But back to school time is here already?
Yes, we get to start today.
You're underway already. Ours aren't until next week.
You're lucky with that. You get the another couple of days. But yeah, I am kind of like you. Like as a kid, I used to always get that sick feeling in my stomach when it was time to go back to school. You hated it because summer was over. And I do too because I love summer. It's my favorite time of year. I hate to see that it's going to start getting cooler and all that kind of stuff. And winter's around the corner. Before you know it, it's January and February. Thank goodness for the Chiefs doing so good so we can always get carried through those two terrible months. But then March has stunk lately, too. March has been terrible from a weather standpoint. So what I'm trying to say is I like this time of year, but this is the end, and they all go back to school, and yeah. I always hate that.
We're lucky we have a neighborhood pool.
Yeah.
I don't ever go to it, but
why not?
Why not?
I don't know. I
wow. Don't you pay for it?
Yeah. We do.
Why yeah,
the kids
you go?
The kids
it?
Go a little bit, but I don't ever
oh
go.
Oh my gosh! You gotta go out there and lay out.
I'm not a layout or a swimmer, but I do get like depressed when they send that. Well, let's. It's closing pool. It's getting close to closing pool. What?
Yeah.
Like they're already starting August. To close the pool?
Yeah. It's like there's like a, you know, it's like a back to school pools closed event or yeah. something. Like, wait a minute here.
I remember
seeing all the pools closed too last year.
I mean,
I'm
usually
like,
it's around Labor
it's
Day.
Warm
you know,
out.
They try to shut them down. But I always like, oh, that's summer's over. That sucks.
It does suck.
So
you
have back to school already there to ease them in with a half day.
Half day for the sixth graders today over at California Trail where my kids go. So Mr. Wiley, the principal over there at California Trail, good luck. God bless.
Well, it sounds
you
like.
Know, you got the sixth graders for a half day today. Then everybody goes tomorrow for the full day. And then they get the weekend. And then, you know, I was talking about it yesterday at the Royals with a couple of the other, you know, guys standing around there. Like, yeah, they go back tomorrow. And I'm like, as you said earlier in the week, it's like there's probably a method to the madness, but once you start on Monday, you hit the ground running. There's no more easing in and looking
you're
for your
messing
locker.
Around for these 2 days. They're like, all right, Monday we're getting after it, right?
Yeah, you're playing maybe a lot of grab ass. Yeah,
it sounds like though the principal of your school's ready.
Oh, he is ready to go. Last night or yesterday afternoon, I see a call coming in from the California Trail Middle School. I'm like, end. Sorry, I'm not taking that call.
Decline.
Yeah. Which kiddo's lunch
right.
money?
Yeah, yeah, yeah exactly. Yeah.
Until your kid can go to school. Yeah, yeah.
Right, because lunch isn't
debts.
Free this yeah. year. You
settle
know,
your debt.
Got to pay up, you know. Yeah. You know, so we got to do that. But and the message is, it's too long to read the entire thing. But I'll just give you the brief synopsis. Hello, this is Mr. Wiley, principal of California Trail Middle School. I'm excited to welcome you back. The purpose of this phone call is to review our traffic patterns.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah. In this way, out this way.
It's the idiot's list.
Yes, it
to
is.
Dropping your kid off at school.
That's exactly
figure
right.
Figure it out, people.
Yeah, come on. And there are at least two parts of this message where they talk about having the zipper merge and how they're going to do it and pick up with the crosswalk, with the buses, with the parents, where to drop off. If you're going to take a picture, go over here. I mean, this is the one thing.
You got to dummy it up. It's sad. You got to dummy it up for people because they can't figure out the car line. The car line is the worst.
It is the worst thing in human nature. And if you're a parent and you've dealt with the car line, you know exactly what we're talking about.
And you're probably part of the problem.
And you probably are. Now, like, our kids now ride the bus to school. So I'm out of this business, right? I don't have to take them. I don't have to pick them up. I don't have to deal with the car line anymore, which is very good for my mental state because every day I would go pick the kids up, or when I would pick the kids up, because I didn't go up because my wife realized this is really bothering you, like people parking in the handicapped spot.
Two
screw
things
you.
Really, I don't get stressed out about a lot. I don't feel like two things that stress me out. Chiefs parking.
Yes.
Oh, big time.
And school drop off.
Yes.
And I'm so thankful. My wife is the best. And she's had to deal with the drop. I would never be able to handle it. And I quit the pickup a long time ago, right?
Yeah.
And if luckily they're in sports, so they stay after school. I'm like, oh, thank goodness.
Yeah.
I could go get you when it's later. But when it has to happen, it's like I'm not doing. I'm parking across the street where you're walking.
And
you're
gave me that
there.
Idea, and I you're told them to meet me in the neighborhood.
Not going in the line. They're like, come on, pull up. I'm not doing it. It's so stressful. I hate
it. It's the worst.
People can't figure it out. They refuse to figure it out. They're rude.
They're self-absorbed.
They're blocking people with their cars. Like, just get in, get out.
Lady, there's other kids. Your child is not the only one who's getting out of a silver minivan.
Let's pull up, and then, oh, wait, they've got 14 bags in the trunk,
right.
And he didn't do that. No, Skippy forgot his lunch money, and he got to no, get your kid out of the car and go.
Be ready to go. Have the bag in the front seat. You don't
just
need all that.
Just kick him out
crap.
And roll. Right. Don't even come to a complete stop. Just slow roll, kick him out and go.
Here's a good one from the text line. If Chiefs parking stresses you out, you shouldn't be driving. Stay in Kansas.
Oh, Lord. Thanks, okay, Coach.
No, because it's a terrible system is what it is.
Thanks, horrible. Pal. Yeah. That's how does horrible. Chiefs parking stress you out? I'm there at 4 in the morning. There's no traffic.
I'm from Missouri, and it still stresses me
it's
out.
It's awful. There's not one person who thinks, oh, I love going to Arrowhead because parking is fantastic.
Tell me that's a smooth process. It's not.
It is the worst parking process in the history of mankind at Arrowhead. I've never seen anything worse. I'd rather sit in school pickup lines than go to Arrowhead, and that's saying a lot. But the school pickup line, it is a self-absorbed area. It really is. Like, it is so self-absorbing in those pickup lines, especially the losers that park in the handicap spot. I hate you. There is no reason for you to be parking in a handicap spot. And I've thought about slashing tires. My wife has talked me out of that.
Wow.
Because, we went to the extreme
here,
right?
The car stopped, and you don't want that.
What's that?
I said, oh, the handy. Or I thought you were talking about the drive-thru. You're talking about the ones that parked
the handicap. Spot that aren't handicapped. Yeah. You're taking up a handicap.
Then,
I'm not just here for 5 minutes.
Then the car is stuck.
Care.
Then the car is stuck.
I'll call Jay Southland Tow and have them all towed away.
And it's the spot's still filled because their car is stuck there. So you want to get them on their way.
Like the other day, we went up to the school to work on the locker with my youngest, who starts sixth grade today, right? And we walk out, and there's a woman parked in the fire lane. Why? There's a whole lot of, and it's 2 other feet the other direction. Park in a spot and walk in. You don't leave your car running in the fire. Oh, I'm just running in to pick something up. Like we all are. Follow the rules. Like, why can't people follow the rules? We're living in a society and nobody wants to follow the rules of the society because everybody thinks I'm the only one.
They're
doing
their
this.
Own society.
I'm the only one that matters.
Yeah, they're their own society.
Yeah. Here's a couple of texts that are now coming in. I don't go to Arrowhead because of the parking. Chiefs parking will be in Kansas soon anyway, so we will stay in Kansas, buddy.
If I could be teleported to Arrowhead, I'd probably work for free.
Yeah. If there was a way to go to helicopter, right?
You know what I mean? I go there to work, make a little income. I'd probably just forfeit that. Like, you just teleport me there, I'm good.
Yeah. I wish there was teleportation because
I would do it.
Yeah.
I would do it.
I'm with you on the handicap parking. They deserve to have their tires slashed. Got to park in lot F for easy getaway at Arrowhead. It's not the getaway as much as it is the get in.
No, it's the stress of getting in.
Yeah.
Because it's just always a zoo.
Yeah.
Always a
you can't zoo. Drive. That's why it's bad. No, it's not bad. It's bad because the system is ignorant.
Yeah, it's just not, it's not great.
Yeah.
It's not great. They know it.
Yeah, and they know it too. Yeah.
They have to know at this point.
Yeah.
I heard you promoting getting your bets done in Kansas. It's close.
We're getting real close.
The problem is some of the Chiefs bets aren't that great of value, right?
They're really not. But they're really not great value right now for what you're looking at with the Chiefs value, because I think what we have with what's going on with the Chiefs right now is that the value is still that they're the favorite, right? They're still the favorite to go out there and win everything. You know, at the end of the day, you don't want to bet on the favorite because that doesn't give you a good return on your investment. And according to a gentleman named, get ready for the never heard of him, John Ewing, he works at MGM Casino.
Oh, JR. JR Ewing.
That's
JR
right.
Ewing,
yeah. He works out there in Las Vegas. And he said the Chiefs are plus 155 favorites to win the West, but Kansas City has the fewest tickets to win the division at the MGM. Broncos, Chargers, and Raiders all have at least 2 times the amount of bets to win the AFC West than the Chiefs.
Why would I want to bet them to win the AFC West?
It's, right? It's not a great return. You're not going to win a lot of money on it.
I mean, they're going to do it, but
and they're going to win it, right? Yeah, so you win 50 cents or something like that, right? So you want to make, I get it, you want to bet on things that are longer shots to give you the better opportunity to get the return on your investment.
It's not always what you believe.
It's not always what you believe. It's right. Like, what are the best odds? And so as soon as the FanDuel app goes live and we can make these bets in Kansas, you can go out there and bet on the Chiefs to win the AFC West, which, you know, they are going to do, but you're not going to get a lot of return, you know, on that investment. And so I think a lot of folks right now, it's called gambling. They may think the Chiefs are going to win it, but if I got 4-1 odds on the Raiders to win it versus 1-1 odds on the Chiefs to win it, well, give me the 4-1 odds.
The other one that still slays me is that the Chargers are the favorite to be the last undefeated team.
Mm-hmm.
How is that possible when they play the Chiefs in week two?
I don't understand that one. That doesn't make any sense.
And the Chiefs are actually a favorite to beat them in week two.
Correct.
By the way.
Yes.
Like of Vegas.
Right.
But
the Chiefs are underdogs in two games this year.
Yeah. The Chiefs are favored to beat the Chargers, yet the Chargers are the favorite in all of the NFL to be the last undefeated team. Mm-hmm. So is everybody getting wiped in the first 2 weeks? Is
I that guess. I guess everybody's losing in week one. Chargers will be the only team to win week one.
I was trying to figure that out. I'm like, well, they're not winning week two. That's a terrible bet.
Yeah.
Why would you be? That's a I wish it was a longer shot. Can I bet against that one with a heavy amount of money? Because the Chargers are losing week two.
Yeah, absolutely losing in week two. So you can bet on that with the FanDuel app too.
Which means the Chiefs will be going longer in that, and they're I think like a sixth favorite or something to be the last undefeated team. But I'm like, why are we on the Chargers knowing that the Chiefs are at the very front of their schedule?
I know. I don't get that one at all, because there are still people out there who say one thing and do another and then say one thing and then do another. And while they're telling you the Chiefs are the best team and they have this odds and that odds, and then the Chargers are going to be the last team to be. But again, people will load up on that. They understand people are in love right now with the Chargers, right? I mean, you look everywhere. Everybody thinks the Chargers are going to be the team to beat, not only in the AFC West, but in the entire NFL. People are in love with that football team. They forget they have a head coach that doesn't know his ass from a hole in the ground on the sidelines. And when you have that, you don't win a lot of games.
There's part of that. Drivers, not in the car line, but they'll be able to go really, really fast this weekend at Topeka. We're going to catch up once again with the dean of NHRA.
Friend of the show.
John Force, always an entertaining guest. He's back to defend his title, actually, in Kansas this weekend. We'll talk to him next.
Keep listening to Fesco in the Morning.
Yeah, that's a great question.
Thank you.
Brought to you by Santa Fe Auto Sound, your home for car audio since 1967 on 610 Sports Radio.
Try it, write me up for 325, more like
yeah,
it.
Yeah, how about that?
You just heard the commercial play. NHRA is back in Kansas this weekend at Heartland Motorsports Park with the Menards NHRA Nationals. Presented by Pet Armor, the defending champion is the dean of drag racing, and he joins us once again, John Force, as you head back to Topeka this weekend.
Yeah, there's only a few races left to get into the countdown. Of course, Indy, but Brainerd and Topeka, which I love. You know, I've done back to back. I think there with my daughter Brittany in that Monster Energy car. So we're excited. We're coming to town and going to be hitting Menards there in Topeka for Peak, Chevrolet, one of my sponsors, and we're going to be back on Friday at the weld plant there in Kansas City with all the drivers. A lot of other drivers. We're all going to be there and pushing our products and having some fun.
Yeah, you guys always do have a lot of fun, and that's what I love most about talking to you, is that you've always had a good time. You've never looked at this as like a job. I mean, you seemingly always look at it as something that you just truly love doing. When did you realize, like, this was going to be the career path that you were going to go down?
Oh, back in my early days, back in the early 70s, when I was driving a truck, I was always going by racetracks or somewhere to buy a national dragster paper to read about what racing was doing. And then telling all my buddies in the coffee shop, you know, other truck drivers about the racing and stuff. So when I got an opportunity in 75 to go to Australia, down under, oh, man, I never looked back. I've been doing it ever since. So very exciting to come in there. And Robert is in the points lead with that Auto Club Chevrolet. Brittany's in the lead with the Monster Energy and Flavor Pack. And I'm third in Proc. I think he's sixth with Montana Brand. So, we're going to have fun. But we get to go, you know, like to Menards we have a Pete car on display, and it, we're signing autographs. That ain't even work. I love it.
What gets you in the car to still want to go 300 miles an hour, though? I mean, you could just retire and run the team at this point.
I like being competitive. I didn't come to be an owner. I come because I like driving hot rods. You know, I grew up in a little trailer house in Bell Gardens with five brothers and sisters, and a motorcycle or a car was your only escape, and I'm still escaping. Still running away from, and I don't even know what, just getting in that hot rod and going down that racetrack. And it's men against men, women against men. I love it. I love the competition, and I like the like a big football team. And I still live in a trailer court with a bunch of racers. So life just goes on. Couldn't get better.
What was it like, John Force, when you hit 300 miles an hour for the first time? What was that feeling like for you?
Well, I was in the 250 club. There was 10 guys picked that made the 250 club, and that was way back. And then 300, of course, Kenny Bernstein, you know, like Prudhomme, my hero, Kenny Bernstein was the first to run 300 in a Top Fuel car right there at Gainesville, Florida. So when I ran it, it was exciting. But let me tell you what's really exciting. When you hit a wall of 300, you get the real G's and the impact. But these cars are really safe. My teams protect me, NHRA, and their safety safari guys are the best. And they keep us well. And I'm here at my age, still kicking, still loving it, and still doing a job for Peak, Blue Depth, the companies on Old World Industries. That's who I'm with. And, of course, Cornwell Tools and the list. I got to get my plugs in here. Well, you know
course.
That. But
of course.
I'm excited to be coming. I love Topeka. I love the way it is. You know, it's a great racetrack. The fans are unbelievable. And we're going to – we're not just drag racing. We're in the entertainment business.
You mentioned the access. I think that's one of the cool features of going down to Topeka. All the drivers are very accommodating with the fans, and you get to go and be in the pit area and see everybody. How big a thrill is that when you see all the fans up close?
Well, you know, NHRA is every ticket is a pit pass. Bring the kids. Bring grandma, grandpa. I'm a grandpa. I can say that. You know, come there. They got a great facility, great seating, a great stadium, great food, you know, and have time with your family Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And if you can't be there, you can watch it on Fox. They'll give you a great show with NHRA. They produce it right there themselves, NHRA TV. So what I'm saying is, and you can meet the stars. You can see the cars. You can get autographs, pictures. You know, go into the midways and see all the different things that are going on and learn about products. But at the end of the day, you can watch not only Top Fuel dragsters like Brittany Drives or Montana Brand with Proc. You can watch funny cars. And then there's pro stock, pro bikes. And it goes all the way down to the little kids like my grandson Jacob and Noah and Autumn. They drive junior dragsters. You know what I mean? And they're only 8, 9 years old. And drag racing, I love NASCAR, love IndyCar. My son-in-law, Graham, is in IndyCar. Got another baby on the way with my daughter, Courtney. So what I'm saying is I love all sports, but drag racing, anybody can be a drag racer. Put on a helmet and get in your car and buckle up, and you're a drag racer.
John, keep the car straight, and best of luck this weekend at Topeka.
That's what I do. Hey, thank both of you for getting me on the show. I like to I get a little bit too commercial. I know pitching the sponsors, but without the sponsors, I wouldn't be here. NK Seed sure. And those guys, without all these sponsors, I would not be here. And I don't know where I'd be. I'd be on the moon, I guess. Okay, love you. Thanks for having me. See you all in Topeka.
John out. 73 years young. Still driving 300 miles an hour, John.
I mean,
Force.
He's ready to go.
He is rolling, baby. That guy is bringing more energy to the table than anybody I've ever seen.
Cool event. Go to heartlandmotorsports.us or NHRA.com for tickets this weekend.
Yep.
He didn't even mention, should probably dial up my son and have him on, the deep fried food that's at.
Did you look at the menu?
No, we've been there before.
Yeah.
And we're going to go on Sunday.
And my son's like, we get those deep fried Snickers again.
I'm like, that's deep fried Oreos. Like, I want that's the deep fried Snickers.
Yeah, yeah.
The deep fried butter.
Yeah, the
I want the deep fried
the food
everything.
It's fantastic too. But yeah, it's a cool event. It's a really cool event.
325 miles per hour.
And you get there right in the pits, and all the drivers are out there, and they're so accommodating. It's really cool.
You know, that's racing, though, in a nutshell right there, what you just said. They still understand the fan aspect of things. A lot of sports have matriculated away from caring about the fans as much as they should. Not in racing, whether it's NASCAR, whether it's IndyCar, whether it's the NHRA. The racers get it, man. You're down there. You're in the pits. You feel important when you go to those events as a fan, and you feel like you're getting up close and personal with the drivers. And I think that's really cool. That's how you kind of grow the sport and grow the game. And if you forget that, well, then you've kind of, you know, are taken for granted what you've got. Racing has never done that. They've never really taken that for granted. They've always really appreciated the fans. And clearly John Force is ready to go. He'll be signing autographs, taking pictures and kissing babies. Yeah, baby. Yeah.
And still winning at 73 years old.
Deep fried Twinkies, you said? Yeah. Deep fried Snickers?
Yeah.
Not as good as that thing that they have at the Iowa State Fair this year that I sent you last night. They're calling it the Finisher or something
like that.
The Finisher,
I believe it's called, yes.
And it is a baked potato that is loaded, and it has an extra large baked potato. It's got bacon, brisket, pulled pork, mac and cheese, sour cream, and garlic butter. And it looks delicious. It looks marvelous. And it's only $10, which to me, I thought for a state fair for something like this, and it's only 10 bucks, that you could feed your whole family on one potato.
Yeah. Put that on a stick. Let's go.
And then deep fry it. Could you find a way to keep all of that on top of the potato? Find a way to batter it and deep fry that thing? Do they sell deep fried sour cream at the fair?
I don't know. Should.
B-Dub, would you like deep fried sour cream dipped in sour cream?
Oh, my goodness.
That
Come
does sound
now.
Pretty good, doesn't it?
Yeah,
I mean, there's deep frying beer.
Come on, B-Dub's one pound over the Royals win total. Now you're
true.
Doing this?
Yeah, I'm doing
Come on.
That. Thing. Did anybody have that Jerry Garcia dog last night out of Kauffman
Stadium? Yes, let us know if you did. 913-586-7610 if you had the Garcia dog.
Jalapeno glazed gummy bears.
Yeah. Yeah. What was that about? What was the fried ketchup like? Give us the details on that dog if you ate that thing last night at Kauffman Stadium.